Welcome back to this third segment of this English Legal System law session in relation to statutory interpretation. Immediately before the break, of course, we looked at the literal rule, and I said to you we'd go straight into looking at the golden rule after the break. Now, I flagged up what the golden rule was when I introduced the topic in the first segment, but let's, by way of recap, look at what exactly we're talking about. Well, the golden rule, as it relates to statutory interpretation, provides that if the words used are ambiguous, then the court should adopt an interpretation which avoids an absurd result. So in Gray and Pearson in 1857, we see Lord Wensleydale saying that the grammatical and ordinary sense of the words is to be adhered to unless that would lead to some absurdity or, in fact, some repugnance or inconsistency with the rest of the instrument, in which case, of course, the grammatical and ordinary sense of the words may be modified so as to avoid that absurdity and inconsistency, but it should go no further. Now, the golden rule is an adaptation, or some people would consider it a shadow of the literal rule. So it does not exist independently of the literal rule, but it comes into play only as a backup when the literal rule has actually failed. So it's usually focusing on the range of secondary meanings of the words or of the phrase which are used in the act. Now, the classic exposition of the rule is to be found in the case of River Weir Commissioners and Adamson, which is an 1876 case. Now, in the case, Lord Blackburn said that we are to take the whole statute together and construe it all together and give the words their ordinary signification, meaning, unless, when it is so applied, they produce an inconsistency or an absurdity or an inconvenience which is so great as to convince the court that the intention could not have been to use them in their ordinary signification, and it therefore justify the court in putting on them some other signification which, though less proper, is one which the court thinks the words will bear. So you start off with the ordinary signification, and if that is going to be absurd or go some way in being so inconvenient so as not to have any kind of true meaning, then you move from the literal rule to, of course, the golden rule. So logically argued, the way to deal with an absurd interpretation is to correct it by assessing what Parliament was trying to do. When can you do this, though? You do this when you are looking at the purpose of the Act. For this reason, therefore, it is sometimes called the purposive approach. And of course, when you look at the purposive approach, this is the approach that is taken when you look at cases being considered before the Court of Justice of the EU. Now, the literal rule will, of course, be departed from mainly where there is confusion within the Act that a clear interpretation is not possible because of the surrounding words and sections. Now, in the case of Stock and Frank Jones, Tipton, 1978, we see Lord Simon advocating for departure from the literal rule where there are four points present. The first is where there is a clear and gross anomaly. The second is that Parliament could not have envisaged that the anomaly, and therefore Parliament would not have accepted its presence. The third is that the anomaly can be obviated without detriment to the legislative intent. And lastly, the language of the statute allows for such modification. Now, it's important because what you don't want is that you move along the golden rule of interpretation as a judge only to discover that what you've allowed is a complete and utter departure from what the entirety of the Act, in essence, does not allow for. Interestingly, many of the cases which have developed the golden rule were in fact interpretation of wills cases. Now, how do we know when something is an anomaly? When do we know when it is an ambiguity? When do we know when it is an absurdity, which of course engages the golden rule? Well, according to Cross in 1995, he says, you have to look at it and the primary meaning cannot be abandoned simply because it produces a result which a judge believes is contrary to the purpose of the act. He says, no judge can decline to apply a statutory provision because it seems to him to lead to absurd results. Equally though, judicial treatment of the topic does not generally lend itself to simply saying judges are concerned only with the internal context of the words, because Cross himself was forced to accept that judicial application of the rule tends to show that absurdity does not mean something wider than, say, irreconcilability with the rest of the instrument. In other words, some judges at least will go beyond merely examining the words of the sections and probe into the purpose of the act. Now, discovering whether something is absurd when matched against the purpose of the act may involve examining the wider legal and even social aspect of the act being passed. That is to say, judges, to a greater or lesser extent, may very well look to the external context of the statute. Now, a case which illustrates the rule, of course, is Re Sigwart's in 1935. Now, in that case, Mrs. Sigwart was found dead. An inquest found that she had been murdered by her son, but her son was also found dead. Now, Mrs. Sigwart's will left everything to her son, but the old rules on public policy dictated that as it relates to the son and therefore the son's estate, they could not inherit under a will in those circumstances. Therefore, Mrs. Sigwart's, the court said, died intestate, which means she died without a will. So the common law rule said, if you left all your property to somebody in a will, but your death was brought about by that beneficiary cannot take under the will. However, it meant therefore that her will was no longer the document to look at. It would now go on intestacy, meaning she died without a will. So the people who would take under intestacy will now be the people who would get. However, under the Administration of Estates Act 1925, Section 46 said that the person who was entitled on intestacy was her son, because that was the only person who would be getting. So even though he couldn't get under the will, the default position under intestacy, if she had died without a will, was that he would still get, and therefore through him, his estate would get. Now, the money had gone full circle in not being given to him under the will, but would end up being given back to him under the rules of intestacy. Now, when you look at the statute dealing with intestacy at the time, it said nothing about murderers being barred from inheriting. Now, the court said that the statute could not have been intended to allow murderers to inherit despite being silent on the point. So the court said that the old rule, which applied to inheriting under a will, was applied to intestacy on the grounds that cases such as Sigsworth would be obnoxious to that old principle and must be read as being subject to it. So they said the rule under, if there was a will, you couldn't inherit if you were the killer, then it must follow that if you inherit where there is no will, the same should apply, even though the act was silent. That's how they use the golden rule to get around that, because of the repugnance. In the case of Harvey Allen in 1872, the defendant was married and married again. It was an offense for a married person to marry again unless they were widowed or divorced. Now, when he was caught, the defendant argued that he did not commit the offense as the law regarded his second marriage as invalid. Now, because what he was saying was, if I'm a married person, I can't marry again, because marry would mean that I would have to be a single person. So he was trying to look at a play on the words. A married person can't marry. He said, I didn't marry. The second marriage is automatically invalid. The court said the word marry could also mean a person who goes through a ceremony of marriage. So the court said, no, it's not about you marrying again, and therefore, because it's invalid, you don't breach the statute. It said the fact that you went through the ceremony meant you married again, and so the defendant was found guilty. In the case of Adler and George in 1964, it was an offense to obstruct Her Majesty's forces in the vicinity of a prohibited place. Now, the defendant had obstructed Her Majesty's forces in a prohibited place, which was an army base. And he argued, or they argued rather, they were not liable. The court found them guilty, as the court said, in the vicinity of must have meant near or in the place. So they were saying, we weren't in the vicinity of the place. We were in the place. So we're not guilty. Again, court is saying, you're too clever for your own good, or so you think. In the vicinity means in the place as well. Now, what are the pros and cons? What are the advantages and disadvantages of the Golden Rule? Well, when you look at the Golden Rule and what its advantages are, it does allow judges to avoid absurdity, which would, of course, otherwise be produced by a literal reading. Secondly, it allows judges to avoid a repugnant situation, as in Rhys Sigsworth. The cons, of course, the disadvantages, is the main question of asking, does it usurp Parliament's legislative function? The next rule, of course, is the mischief rule. The mischief rule is contained in Hayden's case in 1584 and allows the court to look at the state of the former law in order to discover the mischief. What was it that was trying to be achieved? The mischief in which the present statute was designed to remedy. So the court stated there that for the true interpretation of all statutes, four things are to be considered when you look at the mischief rule. The first, what was the common law before the making of the act? Second, what was the mischief and defect for which the common law did not provide? Thirdly, what remedy Parliament resolved and appointed to cure this disease, as it were? And lastly, the true reason for the remedy, and then the function of the judges is to make such construction as shall suppress the mischief and, of course, advance the remedy. Let's look at the cases. The first, of course, is Smith and Hughes. Interesting and lovely case from the 1960s, where we have six women who had been charged with soliciting in a street or public place for the purposes of prostitution. However, one woman had been on a balcony, and the other woman had been behind windows of a ground floor room, kind of like the whole thing you see in Amsterdam or in Holland somewhere. The court said that they were guilty because the mischief aimed at was people being molested or solicited by prostitutes. So they were arguing that they weren't in a public place. They were in a shop front window, as it were. Courts wouldn't have it, and the courts engaged the mischief rule, looking at what the common law was before and what the statute was brought in to cure. Now, when you look at the Royal College of Nursing and the DSS, you see a bit of a moral dilemma case here. This was the Abortion Act 1967, which allowed abortion only by a registered medical practitioner. So we see the Nurse Association, of course, having a concern about this. Doctors carried out the first part of the procedure. The second part was performed by nurses, but without a doctor being present. The House of Lords held by a 3-2 majority that this procedure was lawful, for example, where we have the nurses, because the mischief Parliament was trying to remedy was backstreet abortions performed by unqualified people. And therefore, it wasn't that the nurses were, of course, were falling foul of the law. What are the pros and cons of the mischief rule? Well, the advantages are that it allows the judges to put into effect the remedy Parliament chose to cure as it relates to a problem that there was in the common law. Secondly, it was developed at a time when statutes were a minor source of law and drafting was not as precise as it is today and before, of course, parliamentary supremacy in all its glory was abolished. was established, sorry, before we see parliamentary supremacy being established. Maybe that was a Freudian slip. Maybe parliamentary supremacy ought to be abolished and there be some kind of constitution codified. But there it is, before it was. So when you look at the mischief rule, it is good. There's not very many disadvantages to it because it simply is looking at what has gone on before. Now, when you look at the purposive approach, we see here that you look at the purpose behind the legislation so as to give effect to that purpose. That is the main thing. All right, we've more or less covered all of the approaches that are there. We're going to go into the final section and basically conclude and look at how this operates in practice and also some other minor areas which are of relevance to this particular topic immediately after the break.